welcome to the first edition of our second season of A Closer Look. My name is Mark Shine, alongside my good friend and partner in broadcast, Mr. Mark Miller. And Mark, high school football right around the corner.
Yeah, buddy, it's time. We made it to another year.
We made it
to somebody. You lay low over the summer, they can't find you. Tell you not to come back.
Somebody messed up and let us get back on the air, didn't they? Well, our opening show is a little bit different than our ones throughout the regular season because we have a lot of preview things we'd like to cover. First of all, we want to put a list up today of new coaches in our area for high school football. Mark, last year we had 14. This year we have seven. Yeah. Let's look, we're not going to go through the whole list. One of the real keys or difficult situations, Luke Taviano down at Perry. Of course, he's replacing Herb Lane, who was killed in that tragic car accident last spring during the end of high school basketball season. And Luke, obviously, with a little bit difficult situation there.
Yeah, comes over from Delphus Jefferson. We'll look at them. They've got a new coach. New head coach Brandon Benfeld was an assistant on Chris Summers' staff. So let's tie that in. Chris Summers moved to Spencerville with his good buddy John Zerbe after John retired and became full-time athletic director. So that'll be an interesting dynamic because two of the three Spencerville losses last year was to Delphus Jefferson.
Yeah, a little bit odd. And one other thing we'll point out, just because it's a little bit different situation, JT Bates down there at Van Buren. What's unusual, JT began his coaching career as a high school basketball coach. In fact, was the head coach of a couple of programs in our area and now has taken over the Van Buren football program. That's
well,
a little bit unusual.
They say if you can coach, you can coach anything. You believe that?
Absolutely. If you can teach, I know you can coach. There That's a key go. Part of doing that, too. Well, we also have a lot of new rule changes we'd like to look at this year. Mark, you kind of made a synopsis of those. What about new
There's
rules?
There's 11 new ones, and almost all of them deal with player safety. That's kind of been the trend recently. It's a good trend. That's a great thing. But let's just look at a few of them, okay? Number one, the home jersey now has to be a dark color, and they say clearly contrasting to white. What they're trying to do is get rid of all those grays and camouflages and all that that make it very difficult for us to see in the press box, make it difficult on the officials and fans alike. And even though it's a trend that the young kids like, they're going to try to do away with that. But they're easing it in, not a rule until 2021. They realize high schools can't just pitch gray uniforms. They got to wait for them to wear them out and then buy either dark or white. Next thing is the blindside block. They're trying to make it safer. I understand that, but I think they've really put the referees in a bind because now they're making referees determine a lot of intent, a lot of what it looks like and not really what it is. They say contact against an opponent who is vulnerable to injury outside of the free blocking zone, that's in there where the linemen fall all over each other, unless you use open hands. So I guess if you push somebody, it's not. But if you hit them and they don't see you coming, that's just hard. You know, are they looking away because they want to get a penalty called in? That's a tough one.
I was in a scrimmage last week, and that wide receiver comes up to block that guy chasing the defensive back. The defensive back has got his eyes focused here. Big hit. The crowd, yay, big hit.
Yeah.
Two flags came out. Exact same situation.
Blindside. If you don't see it coming, it's a penalty. So are you going to look away and cause? I don't know. The next one is no pop-up kicks. I'm a little confused by this one. It says the kicker drives the ball immediately to the ground. Ball strikes ground once and goes up into the air. Now, that sounds to me like an onside kick. All right?
Right.
But as we know, onside kicks, you hit the top of the ball, it hits twice and pops up. That's what you're taught forever, and that's a true onside kick. This says once. I don't know how they do that, and it sounds to me like they're trying to eliminate onside kicks because it's, you know, that's a lot of people in a short area. They stopped you from blocking a few years ago, and they're trying to make it safer. The next one is defenseless player. They've better defined that, and that's a good thing. You know, if a kid can't protect himself, you don't want people drilling them. I get that. Another thing that isn't really a rule change, but training required by the OHSAA is called sudden cardiac arrest. It's called the Lindsay's Law. All coaches this summer had to be trained in that. That's a good thing, I guess. 3 points of emphasis we want to cover. This is what you'll see more penalties being called because it is a point of emphasis. Illegal helmet contact, all for that. Sideline control and professional communication. That means coaches get back off the field and don't cuss at me. You talk nice to me. That's what Major League Baseball umpires are going through right now, trying to get players and coaches to respect them a little bit more. And the last thing is enforcement of violations of equipment rules. If you say they have to use a mouthpiece, make them have it in. If you say they have to use a knee pad, make them have it in. If not, it's a penalty.
And two other things very quickly. The competitive balance rule came in this year, so some of your teams are going to be switching divisions. That's something we can get into a little bit later on. And all playoff games will be on Friday night until we get to
Big
the finals.
Yeah.
The finals over in, back in
Canton.
Back in Canton. Until we get to that, playoff games only on Friday. A little bit of disappointment for us because we get to see two games when we play Friday and Saturday. Also a big change because a lot more fields are going to have to be used.
A lot more fields, a lot more referees.
Exactly.
A lot of changes.
You can't play two games at Wapak or Lima Senior or whatever anymore on one Friday, one Saturday. It'll all have to be
on
Friday
weekend.
Night. Okay, so we've got that. All right. Let's go into our leagues. We kind of cover six leagues in some depth around here. So let's look at each one of the leagues. Mark, you go first.
I got the WBL, Western Buckeye League. In 2016, they were tri-champs, so you got to look at them, right? Wapak, they were 9-2. They're my top pick in the WBL, and why not? They've run the table the last several years. They hired more experience on that staff. Dan Allison's a former head coach. Now Alan Klum, former Elida head coach, is going to coach linebackers down there. Travis Moyer just keeps building that staff and building that program. St. Mary's, they lost a lot of good players, especially in the skill, but they got 23 seniors coming back. And anytime you got that many seniors, you're going to have some people that are used to the system. Coach Fry has a system in place. Year number four, same staff, 11-2 last year, a great year. Ottawa Glandorf with a question mark. And the reason for that is they lost maybe the best player in the area for this season, a knee injury to Jay Kaufman. Kenny Schreiner in his 22nd year up there. Still got linebacker running back Daniel Beamer, although we're hearing a little bit of rumblings about him wrestling full-time. I don't know about that. We know they got Jacob Dybul on the defensive line. They're at 11-2 last year. They'll be good again. And then we're going to throw Elida in the mix. They got great size on the lines. They got all their skill back in the pass game. Quarterback Isaac McAdams, running back slot Cole Harmon, and wide receiver Daniel Unruh coming off a knee injury in summer basketball. But those four teams should figure in heavily in the WBL.
Let's move to the BVC, the Blanchard Valley Conference. Of course, they went to divisions a couple of years ago, and when they did that, Macomb and Van Buren have won those divisions each of the last 2 years. Macomb graduated a whole bunch of people you've heard a lot of, the Sherry brothers, Matt and Mike, Jake Krause, Malachi Abbott. Thank you, Mark. Caden Schrader, Nick McDowell, those guys have all graduated, so the league maybe is kind of wide open this year, but let's look at the schedule because I think that's really the key. Arlington hanging on the fringe, but they go to Macomb, to Liberty Benton, and to Lipsick. Mm-hmm. Those are three very difficult road games in there. If you focus on Lipsick, LB, Macomb, Van Buren, those teams, great schedules for all of them. Let's just look at week 10 because in week 10, it's Arlington at Lipsick, and it is Macomb at Liberty Benton. Mm-hmm. The BVC schedule may well come down to week 10 with those teams.
That makes it exciting. The MAC Country, three state teams again. And so we'll look at them. Marion Local, 14-1. They ended up being the Division VI champs. They get the big fella back. Dirksen's back. How about that? You win a state championship and you lose your All-American player the whole year.
Right.
They got nine state championships overall going for full hands. Coldwater, 13-2, ended up being Division V runner-up. They were co-champs with Marion Local, each with one loss. They got six state championships. They've been to the finals 8 years in a row. Minster, Division IV runner-up, 10-5, had a great run in the tournament after a pretty average regular season playing in that tough league. They've got the all-MAC quarterback and linebacker. Talk about strong up the middle right there. They have it. I want to throw St. Henry in there. They were 8-4. They have six state championships, great history. They might be returning to that top level in that league this year, but you know, who knows out of that league, anybody could come up. Fort Recovery came out of nowhere a few years ago and went all the way down there. So
and of course, when you look at them, that realignment and division realignment, they're all playing each other now, kind of down there in the MACRA, and we get to the playoffs. Let's go to the NWCC. One change right off the bat. Fort Laramie has left that league in football. They've gone to the Cross County Conference, and instead they've replaced with Marion Elgin, who becomes the eighth football playing team in that conference, and they will play only in football in that particular conference. Last year, Upper Center Valley had that great year. They ended up 8-4, made the playoffs for the first time, graduated everybody. Austin Sloan, Trey Freitag, Jason Mooch, all those guys graduated, and of course their coach Josh Spencer left as well. They tied last year with Lehman. Dick Roll back for his 11th year, always puts together a good team. Don't be surprised if Lehman struggles a little bit early. They have at Fort Recovery, Miami East, and Graham early. Riverside will be in the mix as well. Coach McGill starts his 8th year there. They also play a good non-conference schedule. schedule. Ansonia, Mechanicsburg, Indian Lake, good non-conference schedule for them. Riverside won the championship in 2015. Lehman in 16 and 14. Those are probably the two best teams in the conference again.
Northwest Conference, four playoff teams. We'll look at them. Maybe a little different order because I'm going to put Ada at the top. They were 7-4. They returned 10 offensive starters and 9 defensive starters. They have a four-year quarterback coming back, and an all-district wide receiver, Bob Owen, in his fifth year, is poised to make a run at that league championship. Crestview, 9-4. Great run in the postseason. Drew Klein returns at quarterback. He was the NWSC first-team quarterback, and again, they had a nice playoff run. Spencerville, new coach. I mentioned they lost to Jefferson twice out of those three losses the year before, same kind of thing. 8-3, and Jefferson at 10-2. Three-time champs in that league, good size, but inexperienced, including a new coach.
Let's very quickly look at the track. And, of course, that conference has belonged to Toledo Central Catholic for the last 4 years. They've been 7-0 in conference play the last 4 years. State championships, state runner-ups, they're going to be loaded again as they bring back several good players for Coach Greg Dempsey. Whitmer, however, this may be the year Whitmer comes back to be the champion. They've got the quarterback, Riley Keller, back. He was first-team all-conference a year ago. They have four other all-conference players back. How about the Spartans? Well, they graduated Jaden Walker, their outstanding running back. If you just want to see great football players, though, they got Keaton Upshaw back. We'll talk about him a little bit more later on. But they also get the quarterback of the year last year in the conference, Riley Keller, at home. He plays for Whitmer. And Dallas Gant, who's an Ohio State recruit, he comes in to play for Toledo St. John's. So lots of good things for Spartans if you want to get out and catch them. Finley graduated quarterback Trey Miller, but they've got an all-conference kicker back in Chase Wilcox. How many times do you say all-conference kicker when you say Finley? Right?
I know. They always have
one. Always have one. How about top players we got returning, Mark, and you want to start there?
All right. First of all, and we'll call it our top 10, but, boy, we like seeing the players develop over the course of the year. And at the end of the season, we'll look at this again. Might be completely different. Brennan Auer, Jefferson running back, 900-plus rushing yards, second team all-league as a linebacker.
Okay, Seth Conley returns as quarterback. Mark mentioned him a moment ago. 3,017 yards throwing the football last year, 31 touchdown passes. How about this? He threw 7 INTs in 388 attempts.
One of our Legends Camp guys.
There you go.
John Dirksen, the big guy from Marion Local, offensive defensive tackle, committed to Notre Dame. That's not bad. And we just got to say just one phrase to describe him. He is a beast.
He is a big dude, isn't he?
He hurts people on the offensive line. What a great player. Back healthy again playing.
I think I got the quarterback. Jacob Huelsman comes back at Minster. He threw for almost 1,600 yards ago, 16 TDs, first-team All-MAC quarterback. He also threw just 4 interceptions in 209 attempts.
Man. Will Homan, Fort Recovery, running back, defensive back, returner, sells popcorn. Pound for pound, got to be the best player in the state. This guy isn't very big, but man, can he play.
Drew Klein, not only is he a great quarterback, also a great leader. If you combine his rushing and passing totals from a year ago, 2,432 yards and 36 touchdowns. He's one of the reasons Crestview will be one of the favorites in the NWC.
And the quickest kid I saw on a basketball floor last winter. Next, Cole Harmon from Elida, running back, slot, all WBL flex player. Never saw that before, but that really describes Cole because he can run out and catch it. He can run it out of the backfield. Very versatile player for the Bulldogs.
Okay, Tyler Schlarman from St. Henry, first team all-conference as a linebacker a year ago, second team as a wideout with 25 catches, 450 yards. Mark mentioned him as a possible sleeper in the conference. That's one of the reasons why.
Chase Sumner, Ada, wide receiver, defensive back, first team all-conference, both ways as a junior, he is a player.
Keaton Upshaw from Lima Senior, he's the Kentucky recruit. Listed in Kentucky as a tight end, but he made all-conference a wide receiver a year ago. One of the reasons the Spartans are looking at having a good year.
And we got a star, an asterisk beside number 11, because he may have been at the very top of this list if he would not have had that unfortunate knee injury earlier in the summer. Jay Kaufman at Ottawa Glandorf. Quarterback, linebacker, the best long snapper I've ever seen in high school. He is a great player. Unfortunate, Jay Kaufman would have been on this list.
Want to get him back, don't we? Let's look at our top games really quickly, and our time is starting to get away from us. We're going to go look at, first of all, the Coldwater-Kenton game, a traditional matchup year after year. However, Coldwater has dominated that recently. They were 7-1 a year ago, tied with Marion Local in the conference championship. Coldwater will be good again. The new quarterback at Kenton is Jaron Sharp. He's just a freshman, but we understand he's got great talent. Kenton was 5-5 a year ago. See if they get it going and get him better this year.
St. Mary's goes to Sydney. Sydney was only 4-6 last year, but these two teams played to a 43-39 game last year. And Sydney has a running back that's committed to Northwestern and a defensive lineman committed to Toledo, so they got some skill.
Wapak at Bell Fountain matchup. This will be at Bell Fountain. Wapak won that game by 3 a year ago on a field goal that actually was kicked in the first quarter. Wapak scored a touchdown late to actually win the football game by 3. Great speed at Bell Fountain with a great quarterback and a great running back, both who can really run the football. That'll be an interesting first round matchup.
Another game at Marion Local, Dayton. Chaminade Julianne comes in. They were 6-4 last year. They are a Division III team, so they play much bigger schools typically during the season, but Marion Local got them 34-14 last year. We'll see if they can do the same thing at home.
And two things to do yet before we wrap up our first edition of the season. That is put our broadcast schedule up on the screen for you. Mark and I will be at Bath for the Allen East game. You can see the other games on our screen here as well. Some great football games to start off our schedule that Ben Reif has put together. And as long as we're talking about Ben Reif, like in addition to the Ben Reif family and in addition to our broadcast crew, Sue, this is Ashton Ainsley Reif. He's the supposedly small one in there, checked in last week at 10.5 pounds or nearly so, along with his other son there, Jackson. That was
There's
Casey in the picture a moment ago.
Yeah, he'll be opening up at left tackle for Allen East on Friday night.
We want to thank you for watching our opening edition of A Closer Look. Mark and I'll be back next week with some of our usual things, the bright spot, the question mark, the play of the week, and all those types of things. We'll see you next week on A Closer Look.